Hey everyone! So today I'm filming a video that I have been wanting to do for a really long time, and I filmed different versions of it, even back when I was still in my dorm room, but I wasn't really happy with it. But I think I have a list of things that I'm really, like, good with that I want to talk about. So I'm going to be giving some advice for all of you incoming university, college, whatever you want to call it, freshmen. The reason why I'm going to call it university, because to me college is a different thing than university in Canada, but yeah, for all of you Americans, this is advice for incoming college freshmen. And if you're not going into university this year, maybe you can refer back to this when you do, but these are just some things I learned in my first year. I'm going to be a sophomore or second year. I just call it second year university. So these are just some tips that are still fresh in my mind that I think will help you. So I've kind of divided it up section by section. I've got an academic, like a dorm living section, and then just miscellaneous. My dog is barking. We good? Okay. So like I was saying, I've got academic, dorm living, and then miscellaneous. So I'm going to start with the academic stuff. Okay, so the first thing that I'm going to talk about is something that you've probably already heard, and it's something that I heard a lot when I was in high school and I was getting ready to leave high school, but it didn't really sink in until it happened. So don't be discouraged if your grades drop from what they were in high school. If you got all 90s in high school and now you are getting 70s and 80s, don't get upset, don't get discouraged, your grades will go back up. I was really upset when I first started getting grades in university my first few months, because I was working harder than I worked in high school, but yet my grades weren't as high. And it's really because you have to get used to the setting. There's a lot more work, a lot of different work than you've ever done, and you just need to kind of get into the groove of the differences between high school and university. So don't get upset. It's happening to everybody, or almost everybody. And if you continue to work hard, your grades are going to be the same as what they were in high school after a little while. So don't get upset. The second thing is get to know your professors whenever it's possible, and it will really help you in the long run. I go to a really big school, and some of my classes have 500 people in them. Luckily, they won't this year because I'm in a much, much, much smaller program. I'm in acting, if you're wondering, but so that's, there's only 19 of us in that program. But yeah, first year I had my psych class that was over 500 people in that class, so obviously you couldn't really get to know the professor. They wouldn't know who you were, especially because we had like 6 different professors for that course. But anyway, getting off topic, in my other classes that were smaller, like my 2 theater classes, I got to know those professors so well, and I can't tell you how much that helps me. If you've been watching me for a while, then you know that my dad passed away in February, so when I was still in school. So I had to leave I was gone for a month, and then plus our spring break was in there too, so I had to leave. And the fact that I knew those professors really helped me, because they were extremely willing to help me out in any way possible, extending dates, giving me basically unlimited time to finish my work, and that helped me so much. I think they would have done it even if they didn't know me as well as they did, but knowing them on a more personal level really helped me in that situation. It gave me a lot of encouragement, and even if something like that doesn't happen to you, just take the time to get to know them, because if you need an extension on a paper and you've gotten to talk to them, you're very friendly and polite, they'll be much more willing to help you than someone that has never taken the time of day to introduce themselves. And that also goes with participating in class. Your professors will get to know you if you are contributing to the class discussion, answering questions. It's going to reflect a lot better on you as a student if you get to know them and get them to know you. Number 3 is start your papers early. And that's something I was good with for the first little while, because I wanted to do really well, and then I started procrastinating. And I think luckily there was only one paper that I was up until the night before, like middle of the night, finishing it when it had to be handed in at 4 p.m. the next day. But a lot of the time I would get 3 to 4 weeks to do a paper. If you start doing your research and even just writing your outline in that first week, you are going to be so much happier once the due date rolls around, because you won't have that responsibility and you can focus your time on things where you might only have a few days to complete an assignment. I remember the first paper we got, I was finished 5 days early, and that was such a relief. I could relax. So definitely start your papers early, because they generally will take a lot longer than you think they will. You might think that you can do it in a day, and then it ends up taking 4 or 5 days to do the research, to write your outline, to do the first and second draft, and then to do your sources and citations, all of that. So start your papers early. Number four, do the readings that are assigned in class. I didn't start doing readings before class until about halfway through the year. I would do them after class. And I got so much more out of the lectures when I did the readings prior to class. I found that it made me remember the material when it came to midterms and exams a lot better, because you'd learned it twice, it was drilled into your head twice, and you could make connections. So if the professor doesn't mention something that was in the paper, in the readings, you still have that background knowledge, which they will probably ask you about on an exam. Your exams aren't always on what your notes, just your notes from the lectures are. A lot of times it's from the readings that they might not have even mentioned in class. Okay, number five, find a study system that works for you, and that might even mean learning how to study. So I know for me and a lot of my friends in high school, I didn't have to study really at all. Maybe for my one AP class I took, but I never studied in high school. I could go into a test not studying and do a test and do fine and get honors with distinction. That is not going to happen for you unless you have some really crazy genius brain memory. You have to study in university, and that all comes to down to knowing how to study. So for me, after trial and error, a good way that I found for studying for me was making up my own practice exam and doing it. So I would go through all my notes, make questions that I think the professor could ask, write them down, and after I had them all written down, I'd have an answer key. I'll go through and do the test, and then I'd mark myself. And that helps you remember the material so well, so much better than just reading your notes and expecting to remember them. Because if you're reading it, you're saying to yourself, yeah, I understand this, this makes sense. But that doesn't mean you're going to remember how it works when you don't have that in front of you to read. So find a study system that works for you and teach yourself how to study. And you can get help from your professors too. They can show you good study tips if you go to office hours. Number six, you're gonna wanna nap a lot. I napped a lot. Everybody's gonna wanna nap a lot. But it really cuts down on the time you have to do your work. So when you're really tired, which you will be, especially if you have early classes, and you get back to your dorm or your room or whatever, take power naps. That means only 10 to 15 minutes of nap time. And this is coming from what I learned in psychology this past year. You don't want to go past stage two of the sleep cycle, because that's when you're going to get really groggy when you wake up, and you're just going to want to keep sleeping. And I did that a lot. I would say I'm going to lay down for 10, 15 minutes, and then I would keep hitting snooze, and then before I know it, it's been 3 or 4 hours. And that's not going to help you in any way, because you're going to be more tired, you're going to be cranky, you're just going to want to keep sleeping, and then you've lost 4 hours of study time or homework time or essay time, whatever. Even just relaxing, like just hanging out with your friends, that's another important part. Anyway, take a 10-minute nap and commit to it, and then you'll be refreshed. Okay, so I'm kind of getting into the dorm stuff now. So the number one tip for that is pack less than you think you need. I can't tell you the amount of clothing that I packed that I didn't wear all year. And when I got home, I made sure that I got rid of those clothes, because I had a wardrobe in my dorm. If you see my dorm room tour, I'll link that down below. That was full, completely full of shoes too. And then I had drawers under my bed, and those were both full. I probably wore a third of the clothing that I brought. So instead of bringing like 7 different semi-formal or formal dresses, bring like 2 or 3 at the most. You're not going to need them. I went to maybe 2 semi-formal events, so yeah, I might have worn the same dress to both of them, so that's really bad. I'm not sure. Anyway, and that means shoes too. You probably only need 1 or 2 pairs of sneakers, a few pairs of flats, and then maybe a pair of heels or two. Like, as much as you're gonna roll your eyes and say, like, oh no, like, I need a lot. Speaking from experience, I was like that too. Pack less than you think you need. And it really helps when you have to pack up to go home, trust me. Okay, number two for dorms. If you're allowed to, I know that all universities are different, all residences are different. If you're allowed to have a mini fridge and a microwave, I say definitely bring one, and a kettle too. I had all of those, and it really has It's really important to eat breakfast every day. I'm sure you all know that. But when you're rushing to class and you don't want to take time to walk down to meal hall, having a fridge and a microwave really helps. I would eat oatmeal every single day. I hardly ever went down for breakfast because it was so much faster to just make instant oatmeal in my room and eat it while I was doing my makeup. So that really helped, is having those options in your room to make your own food. Plus, you're gonna get sick of meal hall food, and that's one of my other points that I guess I'll just jump into right now. At first, meal hall is probably going to seem exciting, and in mind the food was pretty decent, but after 1 or 2 months, probably 2 months, I was sick of it beyond belief, because it's the same meal plan rotated like every 3 or 4 weeks, and you end up eating more than you should. It's sometimes kind of junky, so you're going to get sick of it. So having the opportunity to bring leftovers from home, like if you go home on the weekends like I did a lot of the time, you can bring food from home, you can reheat it. You can buy stuff at the grocery store, and you'll really be thankful to have the option of making food in your room sometimes. Number three, allow yourself to have a relaxation routine. When you're not studying or working on a paper, it's really good to just chill out, have some downtime where you don't have to think about assignments or due dates, anything like that. So what I did every single Thursday night, when the Vampire Diaries was on, I would watch that, I would paint my nails for the week, and I would just chill out for that hour. And no matter what I was doing, I would make sure that I had the work done that I needed to for that night, and then just relax. And it really helped me because I knew that that's what my routine was. I could look forward to it, and it just really cut down on the stress. Be respectful of your neighbors. It's really important, really, really important, because you don't want people around you to not be able to stand you. Don't blast your music, like especially during quiet hours. It's okay to play your music, but don't have it blasting so that you can hear every single word from all the way down the hall. I can't tell you how frustrating that is, and you will experience it. I'm sure you will. But please don't be that person that is blaring their music at 11:30 at night when you're either trying to sleep or you're trying to do homework and it's already quiet hours. 'Cause that's just not good. Okay, even more importantly, and I don't know why I have to say this, but some people will do this. Flush the toilet when you go to the bathroom. It's disgusting. In my residence, it was a co-ed bathroom. They all were. So I'm not blaming the genders, but I don't know if it was a guy or a girl or several guys and girls or all guys or all girls. No one wants to see your excrement in the toilet when they go to use it. It's simple. There's signs in there reminding you, flush the toilet, okay? Just do it. Just flush the toilet. Everybody will be happier. So that's being respectful of your neighbors because that is gross. Don't do it. Be respectful. Okay, and number six for dorm living, party responsibly. People are definitely going to party. It's university. Everybody's on their own for the first time. You're in a dorm. It's going to happen. Just do it responsibly. Don't let it affect your studies. Don't do anything that you would regret. Always watch your drink. Always have a friend with you that knows where you're going to be. And if you have an exam the next day, don't go out partying just because everyone else is. It's okay to say, oh, I have an exam, I'm going to study. Like, just don't let it get in the way of you being successful at school. That's what you're there for. I know some people are there just to party, and it's fun. You're going to, it's going to be fun. Just be responsible about it. It comes down to having a balance, knowing when it's okay and knowing when it's not, knowing when it's safe, knowing when it's not. Be responsible. Okay, and then the miscellaneous points I have to say are, make friends with people in your classes, because if you're sick, you're going to need to know the notes that you missed and have someone that might be able to explain it to you. And it helps if you already know some people that are in your class, but if you don't, just like try to strike up a conversation, sit by the same people, and then you'll eventually be able to ask them for notes if you need them. And you can offer them your notes too. Number two, don't be afraid to branch out from your friends from high school. So you might be going to a school where no one from your high school is going, but for me, my best friend went to the same, is going to the same university as me. We both went there, and her boyfriend, and then one of my friends from cheerleading, and then some other people I knew from my high school. And for the first while, we only hung out with each other, and that was fine. But once I finally made some new friends as well, like I was so happy because it was different and it was fun. And I've made some really good friends at university that I'm really happy about, and just kind of don't get caught up in staying with just the people you know, because then you just seem kind of closed off, and it's good to make a whole new circle of friends. That's one of the really great things about going to university is meeting new people. Number two, or number three, sorry, make use of technology when taking notes. If you work best with taking notes on paper and with a pen, then that works for you. That's great. For me, I take notes much more efficiently when I'm on my laptop and I have a MacBook. And I found that if you are able to download the PowerPoints that your professor is using in the class, a lot of times they'll offer that before class. Take your notes right on the PowerPoint. It'll really help you with remembering the details of what they said along with the slide. And if you're not able to do that, if you have the option and you're allowed to, when you're typing notes into Word, I know at least on MacBooks, you can record the lecture. So you don't have to record all of it, but if it's part that you don't understand, just click the record button, type along with it, and then you can go back and listen to it. And that helps so much. I can't tell you how many times I use that. And sometimes I'd even put the sounds of the lectures on my iPod, and I would just lay in bed and listen to them over again. And it really helps if, because you can't always type everything out and can't get the main points. So just definitely make use of technology when you can. Number four, reward yourself for a job well done. If you got a really good grade on a paper or in the class or on an exam, reward yourself for it. You deserve it. So sometimes if I got a good grade on an essay, I would go and buy myself a smoothie from the Booster Juice on campus, or like buy yourself a lipstick, something like that. You did a good job, so reward yourself for it. And number five, this is the one that I will stress till the day I die with everything in my life. Not just with university either, but in your life. Always be your own advocate. No one's going to be able to stand up for yourself better than you can. And the prime example for that for me this year in school. Okay, so like I already mentioned, and if you've been watching me for a while, I said this earlier in the video, when my dad passed away, I had to be from school for a month. And because of that, I withdrew from one of the courses I was taking. I knew it would be the better option to withdraw from that class than receive a failing grade. So I weighed my options and I withdrew from that class because I knew I wouldn't be able to catch up on it once I returned. It was just a really difficult course. And on top of that, it was a course that I did not need for my program. I was just in it because I needed some fifth credit because I couldn't get into the class I wanted. So I withdrew from that course and decided to enroll in a summer French course because French is the course that I wanted to take but couldn't get into that year. So anyway, with doing that, I became ineligible to receive an in-course scholarship, which I would have qualified for otherwise because my GPA was high enough. So I didn't qualify for that in-course scholarship because I withdrew from that course because I had to be at home for at least a month. I knew that was going to happen. So I was my own advocate. I wrote a letter of appeal. I sent it off to the registrar's office, asking for them to reconsider me since I did receive a high enough GPA. I just didn't complete that fifth course during the fall and winter terms. I completed it in the summer term. So because I did that, they actually gave me the scholarship that I would have gotten had I stayed in that course during that period of time. So that's really important. If you're not your own advocate, you're not going to stand up for yourself. That kind of stuff's not going to happen for you. So if you get a grade on a paper that you genuinely think is really unfair and you have reasons to back it up, be your own advocate. Tell the professor why you think that that grade was unfair, the reasons for that, and most of the time it'll work in your favor. And you can't get that if you don't stand up for yourself. So that's the, if you take one thing from this whole video, is always be your own advocate. Okay? So I really hope all of this helped. If any of you have more tips down below, I'd really love it if you would leave them so everybody can see them, and let me know if you have any questions, and I'll talk to y'all later. Bye.